Hey everybody, stay tuned where Brian and I will be talking to you about what landing zones are and why they can actually be beneficial to you on your cloud adoption journey. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show. And in this show, we're talking to Microsoft experts to tackle some of those technical conversations and questions you might have around your cloud adoption journey. Now, in previous episodes, we talked about the cloud adoption framework, how it can help you with your cloud adoption journey. And we also heard about landing zones, which are part of that cloud adoption framework. Today, joining me to talk more about landing zones is Brian. Brian, thank you for coming on the show.
Hey, Sarah, thanks for having me.
Awesome. So these landing zones, what are they and why do we have them, Brian?
That's a great question. So landing zones are our way to help customers prepare for what they want to do in the cloud. There's a lot of things you can do in the cloud and a lot of ways you can get there. But what we've seen is that when customers have a successful environmental configuration from the beginning, they're more likely to be successful with whatever they do. So Azure landing zones help the customer set up that initial Azure environment and consider things like scale, security, governance, and identity. And it helps them prepare for their migration or for building out net new solutions. It also helps make sure that they've considered all the different platform resources, because customers oftentimes don't know what is or isn't available in the cloud. And it also helps really establish a platform that can allow you to do things with an IaaS migration or VM deployments, or scale all the way out to net new PaaS developments without having to really change your environmental configuration.
Okay, that kind of clears that up. However, I'm thinking about every customer's unique. They have different setups. They have different ways of modeling their environment. How do landing zones fit in if every customer's different?
That's a great question. So every landing zone may end up being a little bit different. But what we've seen is that landing zones all share a set of common design areas. And if we factor in those design areas when building the landing zone, you're more likely to have that successful environmental configuration. So all of the Azure landing zones that we provide consider 8 different design areas. The first one being your enterprise enrollment and how you think about buying Azure or setting up that basic foundation. Then we start to look at identity and how do you want to set up access so you can actually get into the cloud and do things. Or resource organization, which is how we figure out the best way to organize things inside of the cloud so that they're easily managed and governed. And once you start deploying things, one of the most important things to consider is network topology and connectivity. So how do you want things to be isolated and connected? And how do you want to reach back to on-prem? And then looking beyond that, as we start to get into the operational side of things, we have to consider what's your business continuity and disaster recovery plan? Or how do you govern your environments? How do you deploy things? And ultimately, how do you make sure you have a sound operations baseline? So the answers to each of these considerations vary depending on the customer and their operating model. But the questions always tend to be the same. So we center each Azure landing zone around those 8 design areas and build from there.
Okay, I'm starting to get a real clear picture of what these landing zones are. What about, why should people invest in their time in doing landing zones? You know, they sound helpful, but what are the real benefits to them instead of just going off on their own and creating their own landing zone as such?
Oh, that's a great question. So all of these design areas you could build out on your own, and you don't need any of the automated tools that we have in Azure landing zones. It's just configuration of an environment. But what we see when you use the landing zones is that you start with a lot of these questions answered, or at least a certain section of them. And by starting with defined answers to those considerations, you're able to better align your business priorities. It's easier to figure out the different cloud design considerations. It makes it easier to be ready for cloud applications and adapt and grow as you go. And ultimately, it gives you agility, cutting-edge innovation, and the ability to securely deploy while still adapting to your cloud operating model so that you can fit with your future growth plans.
Okay, so you mentioned a phrase there that I'm not 100% sure about what it means. Operating models, Brian, what are they?
Yeah, that's a great question. So if you exclude the cloud from the conversation, every IT organization has some sort of operating model. It's how do you think about the way you want to run your IT business? Well, the same is true for the cloud. You need an operating model to understand what you're really trying to accomplish. And we've studied thousands of customers that are operating in the cloud to figure out what's working, what's not working so well, and how do they really organize for success? And what we've seen from that is a group of 4 different operating models that we've seen consistently show up customer after customer. And what we found is that if you start with a sound foundation in operations, you can do whatever you want in the cloud, and it's easier to do. So we've broken up operations into four key operating models. The first that we look at is decentralized operations. This is for customers where the whole world centers around a single workload or one workload at a time. And you'll see workload operations at the center of everything you do. Not a whole lot of centralization, but tons of room for innovation. Then we see customers who invest in more of a traditional model, which is a central operations model. In central operations, you tend to have a group of central IT people that control access to all production environments, and they're the only ones that can get in. So if you're building a new app, you have to go through them for approval, review, governance, security, all of those things before they permit the release of that product into an environment they manage. Now, what we're seeing is a really strong growing trend is enterprise operations. And this is something that's new and freshly enabled by the cloud. So in the cloud, you can create a platform foundation that has all common utilities that are shared between workloads and environments, but then build up distinct landing zones or distinct environments, some that are purpose-built for stable, steady-state workloads that you want a lot of control and governance and compliance, others where you have a little bit less of a guardrail and you give them more freedom to innovate and do new things. So it breaks up that ability to really take control of what you're pushing out to the cloud for workload teams. And then finally, distributed operations is one that we see pretty consistently with larger customers where they have multiple different teams and mixtures of operating models, and they're trying to bring those all together and integrate those different operating models into one. So these are the four models we see, and each of those share some pretty common characteristics. But ultimately, the further to the right you go, the more complex your environment is.
Cool. Thank you for clearing that up there. So when we're thinking back to the landing zones, if that's okay, we can kind of go back to them. If Azure's changing and constantly adding functionalities, how do we keep up the landing zones? Do we, as customers, have to add on these new products and functionality to the landing zones, or does Microsoft look after that for us?
That's a great question. So in each of the Azure landing zones, we work on integrating the newest features that are available in the Azure once they're proven and tested with customers so that we can keep those landing zone options up to date, fresh, and reflecting those new technologies. Now, as a customer, you still have to decide if you want to incorporate those new changes and if they're going to add value. But by starting with a standardized Azure landing zone, you can compare those releases and find out what new features do, what they add to the value of your environment, and decide whether or not you want to pull those in as part of your foundation. So it makes it really easy for you to pick a common path, and then as things evolve, be able to integrate new features as they come online.
Cool. I'm starting to get a real clear picture of what landing zones are. Where's the best place to get started if I want to start using landing zones and thinking about them for my environment, Brian?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the ready methodology inside of the Cloud Adoption Framework is the home for all of the Azure landing zones. So this is the best starting point for anyone. Inside of the ready methodology, there are four basic steps that you can follow to get going with landing zones. The first is take a look at the Azure Setup Guide. That setup guide is a primer on the tools and the approaches and the things you need to know to just be familiar with what landing zones do. Then the next step is choose your first landing zone. It could be a very robust enterprise scale landing zone, or it could be one of the smaller start small and expand landing zone options. But either way, choose one in your environment, get it deployed, take a look at it firsthand so you can see, does that give you the operational capabilities you need? And as you get more familiar with that or other landing zones, you'll start to see how you want to expand those landing zones to meet your business and technical requirements. So that's step three, is start to expand those either through the portal or through infrastructure as code. And then step four, throughout the ready methodology, there's a number of best practices that focus on how to expand landing zones and how to add in things like network decisions or identity decisions to be able to add in additional features above and beyond that landing zone to really customize it to meet your needs. So those four steps are how we suggest people get going and really go down a path of what's the right Azure landing zone for them.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your time today, Brian. You've really cleared up what landing zones are and where I can go and find out some more information. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to drop some links into the description box if you want to check out some of these resources that Brian has mentioned. And please stay tuned to the Azure Enablement Show, where we're going to be digging deeper into landing zones and showing you how you can actually deploy them within your environment.